and then not. By February 6th, the Army of the Nile has captured Bengazi. This force of Australians and New Zealanders, Indians and Britons, destroy the Italian-Libyan army as an effective fighting unit. They take so many thousands of prisoners, they run out of places to put them. Into the mountainous scrub of Eritrea and Italian Somaliland and Ethiopia advanced the victorious British armies. Truly had Mr. Churchill promised the Italian people to tear their African empire to shreds and tatters. In little more than 6 months, the Italians had lost almost all the empire of which they were so proud and which had taken them 70 years of bitter effort to acquire. To his former capital, Addis Ababa, comes Emperor Haile Selassie. And as he breaks out the royal flag of Ethiopia, the first country which the Axis conquered is the first to be free again. But the might of Germany has not been shattered. And as winter gives way to spring, the Nazi war machine begins to roll across the Danube into the Balkans. Through Romania and Bulgaria, they go without hindrance. And in spite of heroic resistance, on through Yugoslavia and Greece. As the Nazi columns press onward, Canada realizes more and more clearly the importance of her role as a producer of munitions. Prime Minister King puts the lesson of the Balkan campaign into words. Nothing could have demonstrated more clearly, he says, the vital importance in war of superior equipment. The decisive superiority of the Nazis was in striking power, in machines and weapons of war. British resistance and American help are the implacable powers over which Germany must triumph if Hitler is to impose his will on the world. This superiority of equipment carries the Nazis right through the Balkans and Crete and even back through Libya to the borders of Egypt. Canada sees clearly that the modern world belongs to the strong people. As she refires her energy in the second year of war, she expresses her will to be one of the powerful nations. She rushes to complete the transfer of her peacetime industry to production for war. For the first year, her plants and factories have been tooling up. Now they begin to deliver the goods. A constant stream of gun carriers, trucks, and armored vehicles rolls from her great automotive plants. Her powerful industry equips Empire forces for the war on wheels. Canada's shipyards forge ahead to build a new navy. East and west, on the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence, corvettes, minesweepers, and destroyers take shape. Over 60 Canadian corvettes have gone down the ways, and now they take their place in the gray Atlantic. From her reorganized assembly lines come the first tanks, improved Canadian models, studied and adopted by British and American military authorities. And from Quebec steel mills comes the first of many 25-pounder field guns. So Canada, mustering her own resources and organizing her industries, builds her own new tools of war. To the United States once more goes Canada's Prime Minister to confer with President Roosevelt at Hyde Park. The result of their meeting is the pooling of their country's efforts and resources in a joint economic program against the common enemy. The United States swings more of its mighty industrial machine over to production for war needs. New American ships help to replace Allied losses on the seven seas and maintain a steady flow of food and munitions to Britain. aircraft factories design and build new types of warplanes. Bombers and fighters, ever swifter and larger, are tested for the terrific stresses of air warfare. Now the new world is solidly and effectively committed to the defeat of Nazism. And as the measure of their war production grows ever greater, the people of the United States express, through their president, their resolve to furnish all-out aid to the British Commonwealth and the other nations which resist aggression. Today, the supply line between the New World and Britain crosses both sea and sky. American-built bombers leave their home field, roar northward to Canada, Newfoundland, across the North Atlantic, and a few hours later, taxi along the runways of British Air Force, ready for duty. Not all the planes are big enough to fly the Atlantic. All across Canada and the United States, plane parts are crated and trucked away for shipment to the front line. War supplies of every type, the joint production of two great nations working together in a common cause, pile up at the harbors. At eastern Canadian ports, 500 miles nearer Britain than those of the United States, the materials of war are swung aboard the waiting freighters. On Canadian railways, the long freights from British Columbia, from the prairies, and the industrial east travel to the Atlantic coast. Here the wealth of Canada's wheat fields, mines, and factories is loaded into freighters for the perilous crossing to Britain. Emphasizing the vital importance of the supply lines to Britain is the dramatic meeting at sea in August 1941 between President Roosevelt and Mr. Winston Churchill. They discussed the problems of the supply of munitions of war. The freighters with their varied cargoes slip down the harbor, and the great convoys take position for the Atlantic crossing. Royal Canadian Air Force patrols shepherd the outgoing ships, setting out on their slow-paced procession past Newfoundland and the Grand Banks into the danger zones of the North Atlantic. From ports throughout the world, the raw materials and industrial output necessary to sustain a fighting Britain flow down the sea lanes in a steady stream. All the convoy routes and supply lines along which these goods must come cross the dangerous North Atlantic and converge on Britain. Nazi strategy is to starve Britain of food and munitions, and Nazi shipbuilding has one aim, to destroy shipping and cargoes. So battleships and scores of U-boats have been launched to cut the shipping lanes to British ports. From the Kiel Canal sail ships like the Bismarck, streamlined models of speed and destructive power, to carry on at long range the work of Germany's speedy E-boats and destroyers. From bases along the occupied coasts of France and Norway, scores of Nazi U-boats set out to harry the ships that bring essential stocks and supplies to Britain. African convoys, Mediterranean convoys, American convoys steam into the danger zone. If a ship straggles behind its convoy, it becomes an easy prey for the surface raider or the submarine.